Lord God. You're our one defense. You're our righteousness. It is you, Lord God, that we find reason to boast. It is in you, Lord God, that we find our peace. It is in you that we find our strength. Hallelujah. You're our one defense. You're our strong tower, Lord God, against the enemy, against the trick of the enemy, against the attack of the enemy, Lord God. You're our one defense. You're our hope, Lord God. So in the midst of whatever situation, in the midst of any problem, Lord God, we're trusting, we're depending on you to deliver us, to make ways where there seem to be no way, to do what you've done before and do it again. Because you're the same God yesterday, we trust that you'll be the same God forevermore. We trust that you're here with us now, presently. We trust, Lord God, that you are our strength. That you give us reason to rejoice, Lord God. So right now, we'll worship you in this song. We worship you and trust that you'll do it again. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. For you have never failed me yet. Hallelujah. Oh, waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Oh, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Oh, hallelujah. We say, I know the night won't last, 'cause your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Why? 'Cause Jesus, you're still enough to keep me within your love. And my heart will sing your praise again. Oh, your promise still stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hand. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Lord, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hand. This is my confidence. You've never failed. You've never failed, Lord. You're consistent, Lord. We've seen you move the mountains, Lord. We've seen you raise the dead, Lord. We've seen you redeem souls that we thought were lost, Lord. And we trust you'll do it again, Lord. hallelujah. So we say, I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You've made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe, I trust you, Lord, I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again, Lord. I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again, Lord. I'll see you do it again. Because your promise still stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. You've never failed. You've never failed, Lord. You've never failed. You are my strength. Strength like no other. Strength like no other. Reaches to me. You are my strength, Lord. Strength like no other. Strength like no other, oh, reaches to me. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Oh Lord, you lift me up. Fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Oh Lord, you lift me up. And you are my peace, Lord. Peace like no other. Peace like no other reaches to me. You are my joy, a joy like no other, joy like no other reaches to me. You are my joy, you are my joy, joy like no other, joy like no other, joy like no other, reach. precious to me. And in the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Oh Lord, you lift me up. You are my strength. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. My God, you lift me up. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. My God, you lift me up. Because of your love, in the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. From the pit of despair, you lift me up. In the fullness of your grace, God, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Hallelujah. You lift me up. Amazing grace, amazing grace. Grace like no other. Grace like no other reaches to me. Amazing grace, amazing grace. Flows like a river, flows like a river. Stronger than mountains, stronger than mountains. It reaches to me. Because of your grace, Lord, amazing grace, hallelujah, that flows like a river. It's stronger than mountains, and it reaches to me. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you for your grace, Lord God, that gives us reason to worship. We thank you for your love, Lord God, that extended the grace towards us, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, for everything that you've done for us. We thank you for breath. We thank you for this new day. We thank you, Lord God, for the joy that's found in your presence, Lord God, as we dwell, as we walk, as we abide in your presence, Lord God. We thank you, Jesus. And right now, we pray for your word that is to come forth, Lord God. We pray that you just bless, Lord God, each and every person, each and every listener, Lord God, with something that they need, something to rejuvenate our strength, Lord God, something, Lord God, to remind us of who you are, Lord God, not just in this moment, Lord God, but even as the weeks go by, as the months go by, but Lord God, something that will stick within us, that will nourish our souls, Lord God. We pray right now for your word, and we thank you for it, Lord God, that you have blessed us with. We thank you in advance for all that you're going to do in and through your servant on this afternoon. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
As the keyboard and drum are playing, I just want you to keep reflecting on the goodness of God. There's a song that says, "And I have lived the goodness of God. I will dwell in the goodness of God." I declare it on your life right now. God's goodness is running after you. God's goodness is just when waiting for an opportunity to bless you. He's just been waiting for an opportunity to pour out his grace. He's just been waiting for an opportunity for you to say, "I surrender all to you." We sing that song all the time. "I surrender all to you, withholding nothing." But have we been really withholding nothing? I ask myself, what have you been withholding, Pastor Nate? And I've come to a conclusion that I've got to search for everything that I'm withholding, because there is only one destination for each and every person. And that destination is death. Everybody's going to jump on that train one day. But at the end of that train of death, where are you going to end up? Are you going to end up with God, or are you going to end up with the enemies of God? And we don't talk about that destination enough. We talk about blessings on earth. We talk about peace in our heart. We talk about peace of soul. But the life we live is so short. There's a time that comes when the older folks realize that there's so much more that they've lived and so little left. And they know it's time. It's death time. And then there's my group of people that realize, you know what? Time is running out on us to do what we want to do, need to do, how we need to do it. And then there's the folks that feel like they just started out. And they're like, there's no way I could see death right now. I got too much going for me, too much ahead. And then there's those that don't even understand death that ask, what is death, mommy? What does it mean? Because they just got started. Unfortunately for us, wherever you are on that station, on that platform, death is no respecter of persons. Whether you understand it, whether you don't understand it, where you feel you have many more years to give, or whether you feel you're almost on your way out, death has a rendezvous. But in my Bible, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says, O death, where is thy sting? Says the sting of death of sin is death, but through Jesus we have the victory over death. So we need to be reminded the faithfulness of God extends beyond this lifetime into eternity, and we need to prepare for that eternity. And the first job I have as pastor, as shepherd, is to prepare the sheep for eternity. It is the greatest job. It is beyond all other jobs. It is a job that I want to be constantly reminded of, and I'm reminding myself in every breath. As we sang, with every breath I'll sing. The goodness of God is that we no longer have to worry about death. That's the first goodness of God. The goodness of God is that one day there will be some glad morning, there will be joy, and there won't be pain anymore. Some glad morning, there won't be sickness anymore. Some glad morning, won't be disease. And I've come to the realization that now today's church only wants to preach about this topic at a funeral. That's the only time where I hear a minister finally gets up and talks about the life beyond. But other than that, everything we're focused is on the here and now. And the goodness of God is not a here and now goodness. It is an eternal goodness. It is a goodness that started before I was alive. It's a goodness that's going to be long after I'm gone. It's going to be here because it's eternal. And if you want to flow in that goodness, you want to be blessed in that goodness, you've got to conform yourself to the mold that he has put out. And that is why we've gotten together and we started this ministry called Rooted, because we realize that false roots end up with false Christians. And false rules end up with people with an unsatisfied and dissatisfied life. But I want to end up with the life that says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His goodness shall continuously be in my mouth. My soul will take a joy in the Lord, for he has done marvelous things. And that's the life I want to live, the life of God doing marvelous things. The life of me trusting God in the tough times. The life of me trusting God when things didn't make sense. The life of me trusting God that he made a way where there was no way. He did things that weren't need to be done. The life of me growing in the Spirit, growing in the love of God, growing in the power of God. The life where I see him planting a seed in each one of your lives that are listening or are here present right now. And the life where you develop your faith, you develop your growth, and you testify of how God is good. And you testify how we grow from humble beginnings. God is willing to do a new thing, a great thing, a big thing. And I just feel that we're in the season. We're coming into the Jewish season of new beginnings and new earth. And that's the Rosh Hashanah. And in this same period, I feel God is doing a new thing in my life, in this ministry, and you. I don't know why, but I'm just thinking we're on the verge of a breakthrough. I don't know if you notice that, but I noticed. And when we're talking about people on the verge of a breakthrough, it falls directly with our mission statement, you know, which is to reveal the word, the will of God, to rejoice together in community, to reach the lost people, and to reproduce disciples. Reveal, rejoice, reach, and reproduce. I see that coming, and I see it in a vision that God gave to Elijah. And when Elijah looked out and there was a drought, he looked out on the drought. Finally, he came out and the Lord said, "What do you see?" And he said, "I see a small cloud like the palm of a hand." It's like this. And his servant was with him when he told them, "I see." And Elijah was on his knees praying. And the servant came back, "That's what I saw in the report." And he said, "Get up, prepare, because a rain is coming." And I'm here to tell you prophetically right now that what we're experiencing right now is a small cloud that's the palm of God's hand. And I see it. There's a palm of God's hand upon the sanctuary. But get ready, the rain is coming. The rain is coming. And Elijah had the faith to put on his cloak and told his servant, "Let's go. Let's run, because there's about to be a flood, a storm." I'm warmed by the heart of the song that said, "There shall be showers of blessing. This is a promise of God. There shall be angels and blessings descending, sent from the Father above. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops." We can see the mercy drops right now. But the Holy Spirit is telling me, "But for the showers we plead." We can't be satisfied with mercy drops. But if we want to plead, we want to prod, we want to go through, we want to break through in our lives spiritually, we want to break through in our lives prophetically, we want to break through, we want God to change things. Musicians, there's a shower coming for you. There's a shower coming in your life. Praise and worship. Disciples, audio, video, there's a shower coming. It's coming, because the showers are reserved for those he loves. We're going to open up the word today, and I'm going to find it in the Luke chapter 9. I'm reading from a passage that's in our book, Rooted. You can find it on our website and also on our YouTube. I have a link to it. It's a book I wrote for Christian Bible study and growth. And we'll be doing our small groups through it. And I really believe that God wants us growing. It's Luke chapter 9, verse 23, and it says, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." It's Luke chapter 9, verse 23. "Whoever wants to be my disciples must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me." Deny themselves, take up the cross, and follow me. What does that mean? We're going to look at three things quickly that are important for our spiritual growth. Deny themselves. Deny themselves. The second thing we're going to look up is take up cross. And the third thing is follow me. When we read this verse so quickly in Luke 9, verse 23, in your mind and in my mind, I said, follow me must be synonymous with take up cross and deny yourself. Aren't they the same thing? I'm following Christ. But the biblical scholar in me says, there are no accidents in Scripture. So if God asks me to deny myself and asks me to take up my cross and asks me to follow me, he could have just said, whoever wishes my disciple, follow me. He's God. He knows what to tell us to do. And he clearly spoke to a congregation or a group of people that understood that those three things, while similar, were not the same thing. I can tell you that a car has different types of cars. So you can have an SUV, you can have a sedan, and then you can have a
compact. Three different types of car. Similar, related, but not all the same. And that's where we are with this. Deny, cross, and follow are not all the same. I'm not going to say that they're in the steps, because when you're in the Greek, you could probably mix it around and say they're steps. But I'm going to say all three are equivalent choices. And I'm going to deal with them in this order. Deny himself. Deny himself means that you tell flesh you're no longer my boss. Because who is self? Me, flesh. And it's very difficult for us. That's why it's so much easier for children to come to Christ than anyone else. The reason why Jesus said you have to be like a child to come to Christ, because number one, children find their identity in their parent. Say that again. All children find their identity in their parent. And people looking at children find the identity of the children in their parent. They'll look at my son, they say, you look like your dad. They'll look at my son, say, you look like your mom. Or you'll look at my daughter, say, you look like your mom. How many of you had that experience? Like your kids, they compare the kids to you. Once they're grown, you don't see people saying that anymore. Once you hit your 20s and your 30s and 40s, people don't walk up to you and say, oh, you look so much like your mom. They don't do that no more, do they? But when you're 12, 14, 9, 5, 6, maybe when you're like 2, 3, it's a little different, hard. But they're always, the first thing people say when they greet you, when you're before puberty, is, oh, you look so much like your dad. They are finding your identity in your parent. And guess what? You don't get offended. You know, when a kid starts to get offended when they say, you look like your mom, you look like your dad, you know what's happening? Puberty. That's when they start getting offended, because now they are starting to develop that ego. At me. I look like me. I don't look like nobody. I look like me. What do you mean I look like my mom? I don't like, no, I don't. And I, like, unsuspecting people I don't know come here. Oh, hi, how you doing? Oh, you look so much like your mom. No, I don't. No, I look like me. And like, oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. They start to get that freshness. Why? Because they're all trying to identify themselves. They don't want to be linked with their parental identification. But what God said, if you want to be my disciple and the greatest in my kingdom, you have to be like little children. One of the things little children are able to do easily is deny themselves. A child is unable to deny himself in terms of identity. But there's also another type of denial that the child is not good at, but God wants us to do. Children are able to deny themselves in terms of identity, but they have difficulty denying themselves in terms of appetite. Children want what they want, when they want it, how they want it. I was watching recently one kid that was eating, and they placed in front of her some salad and some pasta, and then she had fries and chicken fingers as well. And then, I don't want this. And like, what, you don't like? She's like, everything. And the mom was like, but you eat chicken fingers. I know you eat it. I know you eat french fries. She said, but not with this. Not with this. I don't eat it with that. Mm-mm. And she was mean it. I don't eat it with this. What does that mean? That means that the child will not deny themselves. They're saying, this is what I like to eat, when I like to eat, how I like to eat it. This is what I like to eat, when I like to eat, how I like to eat it. And Christ is saying, if you're going to follow me and you're going to be my disciple, you have to eat what I want you to eat, when I want you to eat, how I want you to eat it. What does that mean? Peter had a dream about food, and he denied and said, I'm not going to eat this, even the Bible kosher food. But Christ said, no, I'm the boss of this. I'm the boss of what you got to eat, when you got to eat, and how you eat it. And what God is saying is, your appetite, my appetites, have to be under his control. Physical, emotional, and spiritual. My appetite for revenge has to be under control. My appetite for pleasure has to be under control. My appetite for food. That is why God teaches us to fast. He said, when I'm gone, the bridegroom is gone, then you will fast. Why? Fast teaches you to control your appetite. We have to control our appetite spiritually. because that is the guardian of the ability to deny yourself. If you cannot control your own appetite, you don't deny yourself. And people that don't deny themselves, you know, when people have appetite issues and problems and they become obese and overweight and suffer all sorts of diseases, well, there's Christians that become obese and overweight spiritually because they become carnal Christians because they cannot deny their appetites of the flesh. You've seen the TV show, the 600-pound woman, right? And that can't move on the bed and everything like that. That got, they weren't born 600 pounds. They weren't even born 60 pounds. But they got there because of a difficulty and a failure to deny appetite. And part of the intervention they make in these people's lives is psychological. They have to teach them. Not only are they leading less, but they have to teach them the mindset of denial. You can't say yes to everything because everything ain't good and everything ain't good at that time. Deny yourself. So the question I ask you is, how good are you at denial? How good am I at denial? You know why you're going to have to be able to deny yourself? Because when you take in stuff that you shouldn't be taking in, you got no room for the cross. You got to deny yourself because God has given you a cross, not blessings, not riches, not overflow, not healing yet, even though by his stripes we are healed. First is a cross. Because carrying a cross marks you as a disciple. Being able to suffer marks you as a disciple. Carrying a cross distinguishes you from everybody else that does not want to go through pain. So the question I ask is, if you're a disciple, you have to be able to tell me a couple things. Number one, what have you been denying in your life? Number two, what's the cross that you've been carrying? What is the cross? And we'll get to that in a minute before I end. It's after you deny self and after you have a cross, he said, follow me. And the reason why I believe this is all intertwined, because if Jesus looked back and looked at you and you got no cross, you probably have not denied yourself. You ain't following him. Say that again. If Jesus looked back at you, you got no cross, you're not denying yourself anything, you can't answer that question. Disciple, interview, what have you denied? What's your cross? Show me. One of the crosses I had to carry was the fact that friends will make fun of you because of Jesus. I was that one guy in college that, was Pastor Nate. I wasn't a pastor at that time. They said to Pastor Nate to make fun of me. And Nate, he can't go. And I wanted to be down, but they knew I couldn't be down. I wanted to. I had to deny it because I couldn't live the way I wanted to live and still be that. Denial. Denial means there's some friendships you can't keep. Denial means there's some places you won't go anymore. Well, you're not going to go for the same reasons. You may go, but now you're going as a fisher of men than a fisherman. Cross to bear means you've got to accept people insulting you. You've got to accept people bullying you. In the book, I talk about a girl, young named Jalem, and she accepted Christ as her personal savior. She was a member of the Fulani tribe of West Africa. Her friends bullied her. Her family threatened her. Finally, they threw her out because of her Christian faith. That was the cross she had to bear. And she bore that cross. She was taken in by the pastor, lived in his home, and did Bible study and learned to become a missionary to her people. But it has not been easy for Jalem. What's the cross? It's not an easy faith. And then follow. Follow sounds simple enough, but you know what follow is? Follow is obedience. Follow. There's a game that we like to play as a icebreaker when we're doing staff meetings and different things like that. And basically, it's a game of, blindfolding people and making them follow directions. So basically, there's two people. One of them is blindfolded, and the other one is giving them directions to go get something and come back. And they have to trust that the person that is giving them directions is not going to be wrong. And secondly, they have to trust that they're hearing the directions and follow correctly. And it's the funniest thing to watch, because you got a whole bunch, like, it's, we do it as teams. You got like 4 blind and 40 people. And once they take one step forward, no, now you got to take one step back. Now you got to take one. And it's crazy, because we put obstacles in a way that they have to listen. And if they're not listening, and everybody's talking at the same time while we're doing this, Dave. So the problem is there's also interference. Watch this. So there's other voices. So they're hearing other person say, go to right. And like, no, not you. I'm talking to my person. Go to right. And it's funny, because you'll have people bumping into each other blindfolded. And it's a whole game. But the point of the game is twofold. One, can you follow directions carefully? And two, can you know whose voice is talking? See, some people think they're following, but the person they're actually following is not the person they should be. The voice you actually listening to is not the voice of God. And in that icebreaker, we have to learn to identify the right voice, and secondly, we have to trust the right voice. Because we got to trust that that voice won't get us bumping into somebody else, and have to trust. So first, we identify the voice. Second, we trust the voice. But even when we trust the voice, we got to follow the directions accordingly. Not the wrong way. If he says take 2 steps right, that don't mean take a third. That means take 2 steps right. If they say turn, then goes turn all the way. You know, people don't know, because they're blindfolded. In this world of darkness, our light is Jesus Christ. And he's the one that said, if you're my disciple, follow me. Follow me. He's been faithful. He's the faithful God. He says, seek me, you will find me. And in discipleship, we cannot achieve God's goodness, grace, and blessing for us without fully following him, which means denial, cross, obedience. Say that with me. Denial, cross, obedience. Again, denial, cross, obedience. So whenever you do a temperature check of your spiritual life, always ask yourself, what have I denied on a daily basis? What am I denying today? Sometimes you might deny something else so you can have time with God. Sometimes you deny something else so you can worship. Sometimes you have to deny something else to evangelize. Sometimes you have to deny something else so you can forgive. Sometimes you got to deny hurt to do forgiveness and not vengeance. Sometimes you have to deny insults so you can share love. And that might be your cross. But when we walk with him, and we go with him, he's never been unfaithful. He's never failed me. When I was growing up in Black African American Church, Chicago, one of my favorite songs was a Negro spiritual that you hear seen in all kinds of congregations everywhere. But I'm not going to sing it. I'm just going to give you the words of it. It says, we come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He's never failed me yet. And the chorus would go, oh, 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 I can't turn around. He's never failed me yet. I'm singing, oh, 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 can't turn around. He's never failed me yet. Denial, cross, obedience. That is the root of discipleship. I'm going to look this week, and I'm going to challenge you this week. What needs to be denied? I'm going to ask you this week, what cross are you bearing for the gospel? What cross are you bearing? I'm going to ask you. You have not come here for a reason. If you're here, I want you to come forward. I'm going to pray for everybody. Musicians, come forward. You can cut off the keys. I just feel in my heart to pray for all of us. We want just stand in front. I'm going to pray for you guys.
And this prayer I'm going to do is that God open your eyes, because I believe he wants to take his people in this last time to another level. But when you have to deny, you're holding back the things that are holding you down. Holding you down. You ever watch those action movies where the hero is about to escape, and then at the last minute, we would call him Creole un vagabond, but an evil man, you know, he grab him, right? He'll grab him by the leg just when he's about to escape. And you're like, oh. And I remember one of the movies, okay, it's a little gory, but one of them watching, the guy goes, oh, what am I going to do? And then he just took something and chopped off the hand. And so the guy that was holding on trying to kill him is looking at a hand bleeding with blood. And the guy's like, I'm out. He runs out with a leg or hand holding on to his leg. But it was the sacrifice he made, because he realized that this hand that was holding him with other guy, that was death. And some of us, the enemy has something that has a grab on you that refuses you to deny. What is it that has a grab on you? What is it that takes up your time? What is it that takes up your thoughts? The Bible says we need to hold all thoughts captive to Christ. What it is grabbing us that makes us not light. I want to walk around light. How many people want to walk around light and not heavy like the disciples? They walked around light. Peter got to a point, he was so light and not heavy. He said, I don't have silver or gold, nor do I have to give you, but in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. That was a light walk that allowed him to let other people that were even paralyzed to walk. And I believe God wants you to help other people to walk. But first, you got to get up. First, you got to walk. First, you got to be unburdened by the stuff that you won't deny. So we're going to make a prayer of denial and a prayer for a cross. That's a hard prayer, because nobody really wants to carry a cross. And a lot of times, you know, in different churches and different doctrines, they carry the cross with a necklace and they put it on them, and that's their cross they're carrying. If it was that simple, we just put a cross on everybody and call it a day. And we all be Christians, but it's not. I'm not telling you that your cross is not worthy and wrong, and that's not what this is about. It's about saying that the cross that Jesus is talking about is a cross that is more heavier. If Jesus was like that, Jesus could, oh yeah, Romans, just put a little necklace around me and I'm good. But Jesus carried a physical, heavy cross that he fell down carrying. It was so heavy, he had to get help. Some of us need to get that help. And that's what I'm here to do. I'm going to pray for you to have help. Pray for me. As I'm praying for you, pray for your neighbor. Pray for the person next to you. Pray for the person around you. Do open up your mouth and say, Lord, help them with their cross. Let's lift our voices together. Heavenly Father, I come right now, and I pray for a release, and that denial would be in the lives of the Christians, the disciples that are here. That would be denial. Difficult days are coming ahead. Days where they're going to have to trust you. Days where they're going to have to depend on you. Days where things are going to hurt. Days where things they're not going to stand are going to happen. And Father God, but in the denial of self, they're going to grow. In the denial of who they are, but acceptance who you are, you're going to bring them through. You're going to deliver them through. They're going to walk through the Red Sea. Father God, I pray for a cross, whatever cross they're going to have to bear. Financial crosses, educational crosses, crosses in relationships, crosses in families, crosses in physical being, physical health, whatever cross that they're bearing right now, crosses in the health of a mother, crosses in the health of their father, crosses in the help of their sister or brother or their son or daughter, any cross that they have to bear, whether it be a tangible physical cross or whether it be just bearing a cross that's emotional, cross about people that they trusted that betrayed them, that hurt them, crosses about people that they don't understand why they're doing certain things and how they can do certain things, and maybe this is wrong and this is hard and this is hurtful and this is painful, but this is a cross that you've given them so that they can grow and become stronger from it. Crosses that we've carried and we're tired of carrying, but we feel we're about our wit's end. But God, we believe in these crosses that we're carrying. We're there because they're disciples. The cross is going to be our testimony, like the cross became your testimony. The reason why we carry a cross, God, you gave it to us, is because one day there will be a resurrection. One day there will be a deliverance. One
day that cross that we were raised up for you in your name will also be the testimony in our name. So just like you carried your cross and you came over victorious, I'm ordaining right now that every single cross that is being carried by anybody at any age, at any time, that cross also become their testimony of how God transformed, how God changed their lives, how God helped them. Father God, I'm praying right now and I'm anointing them right now with the ability to hear your voice and to follow you and directions from you, not directions from the enemy, not directions from somebody that doesn't love them, not directions from somebody that doesn't know them, but directions from you, Father God. You love them, you've called them by name, and you know them, and that they would be, Father God, tight into their understanding and following of these scriptures and following of your trust. That Jesus, I pray that you would do this for them. Jesus, I pray that you would accomplish this in the Son's name, we pray. Amen. I mean, back to your seats. Before we go, I just want to remind you there's always 5 ways to give. We're going to make sure you guys all get copied or rooted soon because we want to start small groups through it. The 5 ways you can give are, of course, through Zelle or Google Pay with the email ftccfinance@gmail.com. That's ftccfinance@gmail.com. You can give through Cash App, which is $GIVE number 2 FTCC, $GIVE number 2 FTCC. The third way you can give is you can give through our, you can give through text to give, 914-292-7770, 914-292-7770. And the fourth way you can give is through our website. I mean, the fifth way you can give is through our website. You can go on and click on donate, ftcctoday.com. Click on donate, and it'll take you to our PayPal page where you can fill out the information necessary. Those of you who are online watching and those of you in person, I want you to fill out these forms for us. And if you're online, text us your name to 845-459-5989. It'll be in the description. 845-459-5989. Text us your name and your number, and we want to get in contact with you to put you in a small group for a Bible study, put you in a small group so we can build on denial, build on cross-bearing, build on following in discipleship, and truly create a church that's ready for Jesus Christ. I was listening to a colleague preach the other day, and he said in his mind he believes 80%, as a conservative figure, of people in church today aren't saved. It's a sermon I'm working on for now, and maybe next week that's what we'll probably go into. He said a lot of us are sayers but not doers of the word. A lot of us are sayers. So next week, tune in. When you have me, we're going to talk about sayers versus doers. But we want to make everybody here somebody that's a disciple. So fill it out. Give us your number, your name, your address, and your contact stuff. After the benediction, you can text me at 845-459-5989, or you can fill out the form. My wife has it right now, and we'll get in contact with you, in touch with you, because we want to make sure we grow in our mission. We're going to reveal the word of God, reveal his will in your life. We're going to reach out to lost people. We're going to reproduce disciples and rejoice in community. All 4 happen simultaneously in Christ's name. May the grace of God surpass all understanding, guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, and we all say, amen.
Thanks for tuning in to Rooted. You can help support this ministry by logging on to ftcctoday.com and clicking on the donate button. Please help us share and spread the gospel by subscribing to this channel and clicking on the share and like button. See you next time.